After about 20 years of waiting for something like this to come along, folks, Apple has just dropped Logic Pro for the iPad. And just spending a little bit of time with it, just kind of messing around with it. Anybody that knows me, I'm an Apple head. And even more so for music production, audio production, I am a Logic head. I've been using Logic now for, it's got to be getting close to 20 years. So imagine my joy and my glee to see my favorite DAW showing up on my favorite device, which is the iPad. So I've been messing around with a little track today, just tinkering around. I haven't really dug deep into the software yet. You know, I'll be probably posting some more videos on that later, but just wanted to let y'all hear what I came up with. Just kind of finding my way around the DAW, and I'll discuss a few things that's a little bit different, but here's what I've been messing around today with. I've been messing around with this so that I can figure out how to bring in some external plugins, some third-party plugins, as well as use some of the elements that are in there. So I found some really cool patches in here that are stock to Logic as well. Off the bat, one of the things I could see is that it's very similar to the desktop version of Logic, in that you can usually bring up different parts of the DAW, different windows like the mix window, the arrange window, the edit window, the piano roll window. You can get access to that, but the way you bring up plugins is not a standard way of just bringing up an extra window. Now, in here, it's more dealing with panes or drawers, sliding panes coming out and showing different things. So, as you can see here, I have about 12 tracks loaded, and I'm going to start at the top. There are different menus that you can bring up in order to either load another track, access loops, bringing them into the arrange window over here. But I'm just going to show you a few things here, some of the plugins that I have loaded. The first one's a Whirly. And if you go down to the bottom, this icon right here will actually bring up a small tile of the plugins that are loaded on this first track. So you can create a nice chain here. If I wanted to add another plugin in addition to the software instrument that's here, I can go ahead and load this, and I can load anything that's stock to Logic Pro. Of course, if I have any other audio units Let's say I wanted to add Mixbox and throw Mixbox on there. And then I can go ahead and open up my plugin and add whatever plugins I have here right in Mixbox. Let's say we want to throw an EQ channel on there. You can get crazy with this. And you can disable the plugins right here. And then when you're done with this screen, just come back to the bottom and get rid of it. And you can see it just slides away. This is all set up for touch. Right now I'm using an Apple keyboard, but you don't need it. Even if you just had the iPad and the pencil, this whole setup is really optimized for touch. So that's why it's a lot of one button, exposing another window, another section of the DAW. Like this one, this is the mixer pane. That brings up the mixer where you can slide through. And if you want to make that bigger, you can go ahead and grab these handles right here in the corner, bring that up, and you can go all the way up and totally mask the arrange window. Over here, this is the browser, or what we would know as the inspector, or the inspector's over here, but the browser window to bring up your presets and stuff, you can get rid of that so you have more screen real estate to deal with. And here's where you can access your plugins. And if you want to add something to a channel strip here, I'm just finding out these little things. It is kind of intuitive if you know where to look. And that's always been the case with Logic. If you know where to look, it's intuitive. But it's kind of getting into the head of the UI design, or getting into that mode to try and figure out, okay, where would they put this? All right, so if I wanted to change something here, on the desktop, I would grab it and I would move it or slide it or even deactivate it or delete it entirely. But here, you have to hit the plus button in order to make changes. And now all of a sudden, you see all these plus buttons show up. And then here's where you can either delete this, remove it, just by one click, one tap. Again, it's set up for touch. So with one tap, I can remove that plugin. I didn't want to use the Chrome Reverb. That's a stock plugin, stock reverb. Here, I'm going to go ahead and throw my Mixbox on there. And then when you're done, go back up here. And you can come right over to here and get rid of the Add Change plugin toggle. So this is like an Add Change plugin button. You can go ahead and toggle that off, just going right back to the mixer pane. And then you can go ahead and open up your plugin here. If you want to see it a little bigger, go ahead and resize it. I love the fact that you can resize stuff and get to see what you want. I love this. One thing I'm not seeing right now is multi-screen support. So I do have an external screen hooked up via HDMI. Right now, it will probably only mirror or show an additional desktop screen for my iPad, but I don't see where I can actually throw one of these windows over there. I don't see that option right now. Okay, I'm looking inside these little areas here. I do see plugin control size, so you can customize how these plugins will appear on your screen. I'm going to suggest just leaving that as auto so that you can resize as you go. But yeah, this is pretty slick, Apple. Pretty slick. And of course, the arrange window is always at the back. So if you wanted to get to stuff, you can always grab these handles and pull them down. Or at the bottom, just go ahead and toggle off the mixer window, toggle off the plugin window, and you're back at your arrange window. Like it's pretty dope what you could do. Let me show you some of the plugins I'm using. This Wurlitzer here is brought to us by Gospel Musicians Neo Soul Keys 2. And again, this is an AUV3 plugin. I'm not seeing that the other types of plugins that are common, the inter-app plugins, I'm not seeing those showing up in Logic. It just looks like they're making it available for AUV3. I know inter-app audio is something big for iOS, where you can have some standalone audio plugins that you can route into a DAW. I got to see if there's a way to do that. They may be able to do that through Audio Share or another app like that. But so far, I'm seeing that Logic really prefers just the AUV3 plugins. We'll see what happens with some future updates. But I love this Gospel Musicians Neo Soul Keys. It's an awesome plugin, very warm. That's where my Wurlitzer is coming from. So that's that. I'm gonna go ahead and resize this. You can leave this plugin pane open, and as you go down to the next track, I've got the Mini Moog Poly D, the Model D plugin for my synth bass. For my leads, I haven't recorded anything on that track, but I'll let you hear what that sounds like in a minute. This app right here, Splat to Clat, this is also by Gospel Musicians. That's where my drum samples are coming from. I think so far this one has been the most buggy. So sometimes the developer has to update the plugin. It's caused a few crashes so far, but I know Gospel Musicians crew, they are solid. They will update their plugins, and it should be running smoothly. But this is a highly recommended drum programming plugin, Splat to Clat, man. It's just awesome. And then you've got the Logic percussion tracks, which is always nice to have a little shaker in there. Then you've got this really interesting studio horns that plugin that is stock to Logic. And the way these are set up, you can either play them as solo instruments or as a section. And as you chord, it splits your notes into a section. It's really, really interesting to play with. And you can also set up some controls over here with the modulation wheel, the dynamic control. You can get some fine control in how you express the notes. It's pretty cool what Logic's doing there. They also have a studio strings as well for different articulations for strings and putting together string sections. So Apple is going deep here, and I'm appreciating the work that they're putting in. So I got a trumpet and sax here that's stock, and then the flute patch. I didn't really find a flute patch in there. So I don't know. Apple's got to add some more stuff in there. I did download all of the packs. They got producer packs, about 14 or 15 gigs free producer packs that you can download for Logic. And again, this is $5 a month. And I thought about it. Subscription? Do I like it? But it's $5 a month, y'all. You can't beat that. You know, for the desktop, it's $200 to get Logic on the desktop. I remember the days when it was $1,000 for Logic 8, Logic 9. It was $1,000. And you would have to get this huge box in the mail with like 5 or 6 DVDs of just pure sounds and plugins and loops and stuff. And the price came down to $200 with Logic Pro X. And most of us who have been Logic heads for years, we were like, that ain't fair. And now it's down to $50 a year or $5 a month. So what's the equivalent? You can invest in this if you don't want to buy an expensive desktop or iMac or Mac Pro. The cheapest desktop right now is the Mac Mini. You know, which you can get into with M2 chip. That's a win-win too. But if you want ultimate portability and the ability to create anywhere and sample anything right into your DAW with very little equipment, this is it. this is it. Right now, I'm running this through a X32. So technically, I can record 32 tracks of audio in. You know, I got all my routing, all my outputs, 32 outs. I can route things that way. Right in the door, I saw all of that pop up. Bus processing, it's all in here. Where I think they need to expand some more is enable the DAW to run off of an external drive. Right now, you can't do that. When you save this, it will get saved to your iCloud Drive account. So right now, it just saved that. And if I wanted to, I can remove this download, and this download would go right back up to the cloud, saving space on my iPad. If you're going to do this, I recommend jumping in on the terabyte or 2 terabyte account. Okay, there it is again, that splat to clat plugin failing to load there. So some plugins that would work in other DAWs may need an update to work smoothly in here. Okay, some of the Rompler plugins might need an update, but so far, a lot of the other GM plugins, this one's by Korg, the Korg Module Pro, that works fine. Of course, all the stock stuff works as expected. But yeah, so far, other than a few plugin crashes, this is smooth. This is clean. I love the interface. I think my favorite part of this interface is the mixer window. Something I found here, because you want to make some fine tuning to your pan structure, it knows if you want to touch it and get granular, it brings up a larger jog wheel, so that you can make some very fine edits to the balance, your panning left and right. Or you can adjust it using this incremental adjustment here, literally one by one. I love this because some of us got bigger fingers than others, and some of us don't know how to move really slightly on the screen. So you can dial it in right here. I think that's dope. That's dope. Or you can enter in a numeric. Come on, Apple. Come on, man. That's just smooth. That's just really smooth. Yeah, so bus routing. Yeah, you can go in. You can really go in. I highly recommend this. You could start off with a free trial. Pick what type of subscription you want. Maybe start with the monthly 5, and then if you really like the free trial, switch to the year. You know, invest that $50 and really go in on your production. Some of us have been waiting for the right balance between price, portability. We don't want to have to own 3 Apple devices, maybe just 1, maybe just 2, you know. And if the iPad is your joint and you love that, and you want to be able to get media consumption as well as your productivity, your music productivity out of the deal, iPad could be a really great way to go. And everything's going touch these days. And there's a ton of really great free packs here. Look at all of these producer packs. 808s, backlight bounce, keyboard collections, drum collections, lo-fi connections. If you want to make stuff for beat tape, EDM, doesn't matter what genre you're into, it's in here. And there are really cool tutorials as well as a demo project that you can actually, that you can open this up and play this. I'm going to go ahead and open that up so you guys can hear this. Take a look at a session that's really full. Okay. So let's just go to the arrange window. And if you want to know what I'm clicking, I'm really toggling the plugin display icon down at the bottom, which changes every time you select a track. It will tell you what's on there. Okay. Let's go ahead and play this. This is all stock. Sculpture. Sculpture was one of those old plugins from Logic 8, maybe Logic 6. It goes back. A lot of FM-based synthesis. Logic has kept this legacy plugin going, and it looks like they've made some updates to the UI. This is such a clean setup, man. I love it. Let's see what's going on here. Sculpture again. I love the compressor. And again, there are different compressor settings. Of course, you got the Platinum one. I think this is most of us who use stock plugins from Logic will recognize the Platinum one. Of course, the VCA, the FET, and the Vintage FET. It's all in here, man. And it's clean. It's clean. And optimize for touch. This is great. The channel EQ, I really like the look of this. You got the RTA analysis right going on. So you can see exactly what's going on your track. Let's go back up here. And you also see a thumbnail of it at the bottom. Look at that. So you can see at a snapshot what's happening in your mix. Seeing what's going on in my EQ just from selecting that. Okay, so some clear differences, in some instances, some advantages to see everything at a glance, okay? And of course, you have access to live loops. If you want to create that way, you can go ahead and record some live loops over here, very similar to Ableton setup. And then you can arrange those live loops to create all of the parts that you're going to put into your arrange window. That's likely how this session was created. As you can see, everything is recorded into these bars of 4 bars or 8 bar sections or 2 bar sections. Nice and neat. Everything is kind of coming together as a clean flow. Oh, man, this is great. And then, of course, you've got the ability to do automation. And I just tapped on this little automation link right here, and this brought me into this pane. You can use your Apple Pencil to go ahead and automate something that's happening on a particular plugin, or if you want to change the automation on on your track. You can simply use your pencil or use your finger to do that. I love that. To be able to change automation on the fly just by touching it. And of course, this is MIDI enabled. So if you're working with a control surface like a digital mixer, you can go into your settings all the way up to the top right, three dots. Hit your settings. You can check your MIDI. You can take MIDI. Right now I have the X32. I can take MIDI from my X32. And I can use my faders to automate. It'll take MIDI input from your control surface too. So this goes deep. This goes deep. Hats off to Logic. Hats off to Apple for doing this and spending the time to get this right. Are there limitations? I'm sure I'm going to run into some. And this is why I'm going to be messing around with it to see what I can get out of it. And yes, it scrolls this way. You can widen the session. You can shrink it vertically as well. You can go wide. All of the above. You could do both at the same time. I love how elastic this is. Because if I'm creating on the fly and wanting to really zoom in to a particular region, it's all right there. So, yeah, Logic for iPad, I see a huge upside to this. A huge upside to this. The UI is clean, easy to get around. Going to mess around and have some fun with this. I did mess around with some of the stock plugins, and I got to say they're warm, they're clear, they feel wide, they have good width, good breadth. Sonically, they feel good. It's going to be interesting. The only thing I wish they addressed right away was storage. But get on that iCloud storage so that you can start saving some space on your device. When you're done with it, remove the download, send it right up to the cloud. When you want it back, go ahead and download it, bring it right back up. You should be good to go. Just my initial thoughts. Sorry, I've been yapping for a minute, but as you can see, I'm excited about this. All right, check it out for yourself, Logic Pro for the iPad. Oh, good to know. As long as you have a A12 chip, which would take you all the way back to the 2018 iPad Pro. That's the one without the home button, the year that they went to 2018. That A12 chip should be able to handle this app and all of the optimizations they've made. Of course, the M1, the M2, that goes without saying. But I love what Apple's doing with their silicon, with their chips, with their design. This has a lot of upside, but I will find the limits. All right, y'all. Take care.